Hello, I'm Cherise Duncan with Great Ideas on CPCC-TV, where we talk with entrepreneurs from startup to viable businesses. I have my solar energy, and I'm going to go talk to Suzanne Wilkerson with Avert Energy. Suzanne, welcome to Great Ideas. Thanks so much for being on the show today.
Well, Cherise, thanks for inviting us. We're excited to be part of your program.
Well, I'm excited to learn about Avert Energy, and I understand that you are an energy solutions company. So tell our audience what that means.
That is correct. We are an energy consulting company that comes in and helps people create solutions. Everything that happens behind the meter in a company and how they consume energy today in buildings and different institutions. And we work to give them solutions to improve their top line or drive their business and save them money on the bottom line and reduce their energy consumption.
Now, where did the idea of Avert Energy come from?
Well, basically, having been in business for 25 years, I was looking at what was trending. People around me were talking about kind of what the challenges of the future were, and we really saw energy as a challenge for American companies.
Now, as far as the industry, is the industry called the energy industry, or what industry are you in?
Well, you know, when you look at the Department of Energy for the United States of America, you start to see what energy is about. Energy is kind of broken out into two classifications, the traditional energy sector, which is energy production, coal, nuclear, and then the alternative or clean tech energies. My company focuses really in both spaces because people today are consuming from both sides.
Now, as far as your solutions, you say that you offer turnkey solutions.
That's correct.
Now, we hear that term a lot. It's kind of a buzzword, if you will. Can you tell us what turnkey means and specifically to your solutions?
Sure. Well, the first thing is we're not only turnkey, but we're disruptive solutions. And what that means is your traditional solutions are now going to be disrupted by something new. So, for example, U.S. Post Office, in comes Federal Express. In this particular case, a turnkey solution for us is that we walk into a company, we work with the C-suite of people first to analyze what the business impact of our solutions are, and then we work with operations people like the energy manager. We come in and we bring a hardware solution coupled with a software solution. In this case, the disruptive piece is that we're cloud-based and we're not interfacing with traditional networks. The degree of information you receive off of energy consumption in a building is pretty high. And today we found that that's been very disruptive in traditional networks that are otherwise handling, you know, typical IT work. And so we put the whole solution together, basically help the customer understand the top line and the bottom line, and then we design it and we help the company implement it.
Now tell us again about disruptive. You mentioned that word a couple of times, and I know you've talked about it a little bit, but give us a clear definition of what you mean by that.
Disruptive technologies are typically technologies that come in and take what was the status quo and change it, particularly when you see times are changing. When I worked at Oracle, there was an operating system called Linux, and it was able to come in and work much quicker than the traditional operating systems, and that really changed the way data centers were managed, and that started around 2000. But throughout history, you can, for example, you saw Federal Express as a solution. That disrupted the U.S. Post Office and some of the global postal systems. So typically, when you see mature businesses, disruptive technologies or solutions come in, and they change how things are done. They change the price points. They change possibly the speed to delivery. And so we've introduced this cloud-based energy efficiency hardware-software solution with a total turnkey, meaning we come in from day one, look at the business objectives, look at the energy consumption, implement the system, and give them measurable results year over year.
And I know you and I talked before the show a little bit about strategic partnerships and how important that is for small business owners. So talk to us a little bit about your strategic alliances, like you mentioned, to get the work done and do a quality job.
Well, part of our initial research, when we looked at the competitors in the marketplace and what was happening in energy, is we quickly realized that there were a few firms that were really well-established and had high reputations. We came in with Optima Engineering. They built one of the first platinum LEED certified buildings in North Carolina. They are energy experts and are really accredited. So we ended up meeting the owner, Keith Pale, and signing a legal binding strategic alliance agreement for delivery of our solution. Then we also found a second company who has really co-created the hardware and software and cloud solution with us, Livingston and Haven. And they're a third generation company, also very accredited. So those two relationships really brought credibility to our organization, helped us bring that deep expertise where we were drawing more from our business relationships. They were able to help us create the right solutions, tried and true things, and yet still bring in disruptive technology because they understood the baseline.
And it sounds like, you know, you have to have a team of people that are not only qualified and have the skill sets, but I think that are really interested in what you're doing and interested in the industry. Have you been successful in finding good team members?
Oh, absolutely. I would definitely say this is a passion-based business. Yeah. It's not something that you can do if you really just don't have the drive. The other thing that we found when we're looking at business, because of our tenure, is values are very, very important. So integrity, how you go about getting things done, because there's more than one way to find a solution. But when you really think about an industry phase that we faced every day, the triple bottom line, people, planets, and profits, keeping those three things in balance is really important. We want companies to be happy, we want the people working in those companies to be happy, and we want the planet to stay good.
Have you worked in this industry before? Did it just intrigue you?
Well, it's a very good question. So after, 20 plus years in the corporate world, I've always had a passion around energy, renewable energy, sustainability, recycling, green. I was born and raised in Canada. I think it came from, the genes. And I've always had a passion around that. And I wanted to eventually, I didn't know what it was, but I want to eventually get into green. And this opportunity with Avert came about. Suzanne's and her values and some of the ways that the company goes to market was exactly what I wanted to. So I was able to tie my business experience with the passion that I've had in this company, which is wonderful. So we all bring something to the company, different skill sets and so on. You know, my background being process, change management, obviously Six Sigma, I tend to be the guy that handles the operational side of the house, or project plans, or how to go to market with our DMAIC methodology. We tend to apply that as a company, but I'm the guy that structures it a lot around going out to bids or with some of our clients and making sure that we execute accordingly on those processes and hence secure the order. We don't want to go out to market haphazardly, recommend a solution that doesn't work, and then fall on our faces later with our client. Our client satisfaction is very key, and so we apply those methodologies to make sure we're successful. I think that's the biggest piece that I bring to the company.
How did you find CPCC Institute for Entrepreneurship?
Well, we came out and we were looking at obviously starting a company, and it's kind of tough when you're at a later stage in life.
Yes.
And you say, okay, well, where's the beginning and where's the middle and where's the end? So we actually saw an advertisement for the Kauffman Institute, and it was being deployed by CPCC. And we went into this program called the Fast Track. They basically took a year's curriculum and distilled it down to 6 weeks. And that was really a good solution for us because we didn't have time to go back to school, per se. But dedicating one day a week for 6 weeks was an ideal timeline. And obviously, it was a very rigorous course that CPCC orchestrated and just kind of gave you soup to nuts. What did you need to do to think about, engage, and build out a business platform?
And you know, I've been in business 16 years, so I definitely understand about going back to school and getting your education. But an offering like Central Piedmont Community College's Institute for Entrepreneurship and the classes and the programs and the staff, I think is a great asset to any entrepreneur.
Well, always wanting to grow is very important. And the shift now moving from the traditional banking sector or industrial sector with GE into green and sustainability, I knew that I had certainly some gaps in my portfolio. So I was very interested. I went online to CPCC and looked up classes around sustainability and renewable energy and so on, and found exactly the classes I was looking for, namely a class with Professor Moody, who is a LED certification class, which was right up my alley. And as I read the description, it talked about how it incorporates into building design, how it works with commercial applications, which is a sweet spot for our customer base. And then it also talks about measurement, which is, again, right tied into our methodology around Six Sigma and capturing metrics and proper measurements in order to implement the right solutions.
So, you know, we've been there, the 3-year, the 5-year, the 7-year-old businesses, and any tips that you can give our audience out there of how to stay motivated and push forward?
Yes, definitely. In my perspective, number one, follow your passion. because there's nothing easy, and you will be able to do it if you're passionate about it. The second thing is it takes a village. You know, surround yourself with organizations like CPCC, Strategic Alliance Partners, because they will help you through the rough parts. And probably lastly, I would say, you know, look at the financial aspects. You really plan for the 3 and 5 year and back your way out of it, because it does take a lot of resources and it takes time. And so you have to figure out how you're going to maneuver the financial aspect of that.
I think one of the key aspects of a successful business as well as a successful partnership is making sure that we all bring something different to the company. We don't. The important thing, and I think Suzanne would agree, we don't want to have a whole bunch of Suzannes in the company. I think it's important that we have strengths in different area that each partner can bring that brings a full complement to the business. So now we have a full complementary business that we can go to market that has all the skill sets that we need to be successful.
That energy lesson was great. Suzanne and her team were wonderful. Now I'm going to go speak with Duran Rathod of DR Construction, Inc. We're actually meeting him at his home, which was his first construction project. Duran, thank you so much for joining us on Great Ideas. I'm so glad you decided to share with us your beautiful home. So welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here.
Well, you own DR Construction, Inc.
Right.
And I understand you have a tennis background.
I sure do.
So how did you go from tennis to a construction company?
You know, I've taught tennis for 18 years, and I had achieved all the goals. And then I said to myself, what's next? So when this opportunity came, I said, let's go and do our own business, mm-hmm. construction business. And we can start with a small business. We can go forward and see what happens. So since 2004, you know, we formed the company with the help of CPCC and all the courses I've taken there. And with the right information,
yes,
I was able to move forward.
Now, when you say when the opportunity came, where did the opportunity come from? How did that happen? I know you mentioned something about some classes and
right.
you didn't know if you were going to pass a test.
Right, that's right. After I took all the courses there, construction courses, and through, they had different people, speakers come and talk. And with that in mind, I was very confident. So we built our first house back in 2000. The one we are in right now. And with that in mind, I felt pretty good. Then I took my commercial building course exam so I could be a general contractor. And I passed the test. So with that in mind, I said, well, this is the right time to move forward. Mm-hmm. And let's go and jump into having your own company. That's how I got started.
Wonderful. So now we hear the rumors about the construction industry. It's up, it's down, it's out.
Yes.
So tell me, how is the industry doing specifically to what you do?
You know, I used to really look at the new construction with the clients. But now, as the industry has changed because of the market, so now we are focusing on renovations, remodeling, additions to the house, because the homeowners are not moving out, and they're staying.
They're staying. So you do residential?
Yes, I do both, commercial and residential. Mm-hmm. But lately I've been doing more residential. That's the way it has come to me. So I've been working on towards renovations, rehab, additions, remodeling, kitchen or bathroom.
Well, and that's smart, because most people think, okay, what I'm doing now is not working, so I'm going to stop and go work for corporate America.
Right.
But you were smart to say, okay, they're staying, so let me do some remodel and
right.
renovations.
Right. That's why, you know, I changed my strategy. Instead of going to new construction and trying to work toward the higher end, so let me kind of back off and start with the homeowners, what they want in the house. So with that in mind, I picked out the target, The right target is the renovations, additions, rehab, that kind of stuff. And so I've been marketing that in that direction. And it has worked so far.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, running a tennis program, you know, that's a lot of work. It's a lot of fun, too. Yeah. So did that help you when you first started your business and planning and organizing? And, you know, we always talk about the business side of the business.
Right. Because when you run your own show at a tennis complex or at the country club level, and you're in charge of the whole department, that means you got to be dedicated. You have to have a work ethics and the right attitude, and make sure that you have the right personnel with that department. So all those things helped me to move forward with my business. Mm-hmm. And I have applied the same qualities from my tennis career to construction.
Now, do you still play tennis?
I sure do.
I was going to say, because as an entrepreneur, you need that outlet.
Yes.
You know, so you found the balance, because we all have passions.
Yes.
And then we move from one passion to starting a business.
Right.
You know, that balance.
Right.
You know, we don't necessarily have it. So have you been able to keep the balance and
yes.
maintain your sanity?
I sure do, because I always go out there at the parks and play and meet more people, and a few high schools have called me to teach their program. It's like a two month program, so that's fine. You know, I can have that in the afternoon and talk to more people and what they do. Mm-hmm. And passion is to teach the young kids.
Yeah.
So that's a good thing.
Well, and it's a way for you, like you said, to stay connected to the community.
Right.
So it's connections for DR Construction.
That is correct. That is correct.
So what about marketing and sales? How are you doing or getting your name out there, especially with what people say about the construction industry?
Right. I've got my own website, Facebook, LinkedIn. All those pages are there.
You're social networking?
Yes, I am.
That's good.
With the core class I took at CPCC, that has gone into more depth. What we want to do to achieve our goals. Mm-hmm. So I've been following that format. So I was able to get the website started, and Facebook and the LinkedIn and the YouTube. So I'm getting in that mainstream.
Yeah, you're on YouTube?
Well, we will be shortly.
So what do you have plans for YouTube? Are you going to be demonstrating your homes and the way that you construct the homes and renovate?
Right. Behind the scenes, what happens and how the things work. Mm-hmm. And give them some tidbits, what to do, what not to do during the winter months or the summer months, you know, how things work in the house. So we can give those kind of tips on YouTube and let people know how things work.
Now, explain to us how involved you are with the actual renovation and construction, because you do own the company, so I know sometimes you have to separate yourself. So how much work do you do on projects versus managing the projects?
I think it's like 50-50, because I'm on the job site. I'm on hands-on contractor. So if something doesn't look right to me, I will go and fix it. Mm-hmm. Even though we have subcontractors working at the job site, and I always go behind them, see how they're doing. So I'm on site almost every day. At the same time, when I see that job is done right, then I kind of back off and start doing my management area. So it's like a 50-50 proposition.
Have you found that has worked for you? Because I know some construction companies, when I talk to their owners, you know, they spend too much time on the site because they love it so much. So it sounds like it's working for you.
I think it is working, yeah. And I think I want to keep it that way. Mm-hmm. The main thing is to get the right people working with you along the side and have the same vision what you have for your company, which is more detailed work and quality. So that's where I emphasize on.
They have to understand the beauty of what you do.
Right, yes.
So how do you find good people?
Just networking, trying to find the right people through the other contacts. And once you learn, you know what not to get and what to have on your team. So it takes time, but, you know, so I think it's working right now.
So sometimes you've hired people and they didn't work out, but like you said, it's a lesson learned.
Right,
so
lesson learned.
You still go through the motions, though.
Yeah, I sure do. Yes. And then as a company, as a project manager, it's you. That's the bottom line. So I want to make sure that I hire the right people to do the right job.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned CPCC, Institute for Entrepreneurship.
Right.
So talk to me about some of the skill sets that maybe you were lacking and you were able to utilize CPCC to help you achieve those skills.
Being a hands-on guy, I love construction. That's my in the background. So I learned the safety part from Construction Institute. Safety and the tools, how to use them, what the methods are, how to build projects. And with that in mind, you know, I was able to fully comprehend what they were telling me mm-hmm. in the courses. So I was able to employ all those practices into really projects. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's the bottom line. You have to learn all those things from CPCC and get that knowledge into practical way doing things.
And you did attend the CORE program.
Yes.
And you say you still read your manuals. So you mentioned strategy and being more focused. So you're still utilizing the curriculum from the class. And how has it helped you with planning and organizing your business?
It is an in-depth class. It has really helped me. So I've been following that curriculum from the get-go, and even though it's in depth, you know, I'm following the right chapters along the way, mm-hmm. and it has helped. I can see the results, so I'm very optimistic that if you follow that curriculum, it will pay dividends down the road.
Well, and I mean, I'm looking around in your home, and I can definitely see the result. This is beautiful.
Thank you.
So this was one of your first projects, right?
This was our first project. It was from ground up, and I was a general contractor.
Mm-hmm. And when you say ground up, you mean like there was nothing here?
Nothing here, just the bare ground. And then we opened up and cleaned the trees and the lot the way we want to keep it. And from the ground up means footings, foundation, up to the dried-in phase. And after that, I moved in. I did all the work inside, mainly the floors, then the trim, mm-hmm. and the tile work, because of the expertise from CPCC, when they gave me all the knowledge, mm-hmm. how to do things right.
And you use this home, I mean, this is your home. It's very comfortable.
Thank
I feel
you.
Great here.
Thank you.
But you also use it as a showcase for that your clients.
That is correct.
So tell us about that.
I bring them in here and let them see different ways of looking at things, the quality, if that's what they want, wood, brick.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, so they can pick and choose what they like. Mm-hmm. And once they know that I go beyond the basic code of the city, then they understand, hey, this is a well-built house. So with that in mind, I'll bring them here, let them see the product.
Well, and I think that's great. Most entrepreneurs don't want people to come to their
yes.
come to their homes and their home office. So that just shows how much pride you have in your work and how, you know, how well
yes.
you construct homes.
Yes, yes.
So let's leave our audience with three tips,
okay.
Especially those who are in the construction industry and they're not adapting to change. So what three things can you tell them to focus on if they want to maintain their business and move forward?
Loyalty to the customer, number one. Number two is dedication. You have to wear different hats at this time in your business. And number three, listen to your homeowners, what they're saying, what they want. And if you look at the trend that they are moving toward lots of renovations and additions and remodeling, so that's where the things are moving. So you pay attention to the homeowner and the clients, what they want. And that's probably one of the things I've learned.
Thanks for joining us with Great Ideas. If entrepreneurship is on your agenda, go to cpcc.edu and do a search for entrepreneurship. This is Cherise Duncan with Great Ideas.